With the never-ending increase in energy demand and the posing threat of global warming, the world undoubtedly needs a new source of abundant and clean energy. There has been a substantial growth in renewable energies, such as wind and solar, but they tend to be seasonal and unreliable, so they cannot provide a constant base load as other sources do. Recently, an old idea has reappeared on the energy stage, promising clean, abundant, and limitless energy. The idea of infinite energy has sparked an interest among many countries which are working to unlock the secrets of nuclear fusion. The word nuclear tends to be scary and associated with destruction and radiation, but that's not the case with fusion. Let's take a look at how fusion is different than the well-known fission reaction. So fission is a nuclear reaction going in the opposite direction of fusion. Fission is the splitting of nuclei of heavy elements such as uranium-235 and producing lighter elements and large amounts of energy. Fission is relatively easy to initiate compared to fusion. It takes a neutron at room temperature fired at a uranium nucleus. Because the neutron doesn't have a charge, it can interact with the nucleus without being repelled by the protons. If the velocity of the neutron is right, it will split the nucleus apart, creating new elements and releasing new, high-energy neutrons. The produced neutrons can cause more fission reactions and end up in a chain reaction. Nuclear reactors control this chain reaction through control rods and prevent uncontrollable release of energy. The thermal energy released is harnessed through turbines, which turn steam into mechanical and then electrical energy. Now, nuclear fusion is the opposite process, where light elements get fused or combined together into a heavier element. The proposed fuel for a fusion reactor are two hydrogen isotopes, deuterium and tritium, which are fused into helium. If we compare the mass of these two heavy hydrogen isotopes to the mass of the products, helium or alpha particle and a high energy neutron, we can notice that the mass of the reactants is more than the mass of the products. Since the products are less massive, Einstein explains with his famous E equals mc squared that the mass difference must be released in a different form of energy, in this case velocity or heat. And that's the limitless energy that scientists are trying to harness. But why is fusion energy so attractive? There are several reasons why unlocking fusion may solve many of today's global issues. For example, from one bathtub of water and two laptop batteries, we can produce a few grams of fusion fuel. These few grams of fuel can produce enough power for a person's entire life. So it becomes pretty obvious that fusion promises a lot. Fusion is so attractive and important because, for fuel, it uses elements which are abundant on Earth and could provide power for thousands of years. Fusion does not release greenhouse gases, which makes this technology a potential solution for global warming. Fusion does not initiate a chain reaction, so meltdown is not a real possibility. Fusion does not emit gamma radiation, but instead alpha radiation, which is harmless since it cannot even penetrate a sheet of paper. And fusion is not seasonal, so it can provide a constant base load. Now, the only real cause of this technology is that we can't really make it work yet, and it requires an enormous capital investment. But why is the fusion reaction so hard to sustain? Well, for two nuclei to fuse, they need to be extremely close to each other. We're talking 10 to the minus negative 14 meters close. That wouldn't be so hard if the nuclei didn't repel each other due to their positive charge. To overcome this repulsive force, the nuclei must have a lot of energy, and by a lot of energy I mean 10 times hotter than the core of the Sun, or about 100 million degrees Celsius. But that's actually not the main issue. Scientists achieve this temperature pretty often during tests. Now, even if the amount of energy is right, the nuclei tend to rather scatter away than to fuse. Because of that, the fuel needs to be confined. Analogous to this would be trying to squeeze a balloon into a smaller shape. The balloon would much rather bulge out than compress its size. The Sun is a successful fusion reactor which uses its enormous gravity to confine its fuel at its core and force it to fuse. We do not have that kind of gravity on Earth, so we have to be more creative in confining the fuel. For confinement on Earth, we use enormous magnetic fields that prevent the ionized plasma from scattering away. Without a magnetic field, the particles tend to move fast in all directions. When a magnetic field is introduced, the particles move only along the magnetic field lines, which prevents scattering. One of the best devices for magnetic confinement is the tokamak. An experiment in the UK, known as JET, uses a tokamak and successfully produces fusion energy. JET has not yet reached net positive energy gain. It produced 16 megawatts of energy but consumed 25 megawatts in the process, which is a Q of about 0.65. From the graph we can see that fusion energy has come a long way since the early 1990s, where the Q value was around 0.1. However, recently, the development of fusion energy stalled, and the reason why is because the size of the equipment has gotten so large that it requires multinational funding. Until several years ago, the superconductors could not produce magnetic fields stronger than 6 Tesla, which meant that the only way to achieve a higher energy gain was to increase the size of the device, which drove the cost insanely high. Luckily, now there is a new superconductor called REPCO that unlocks the second part of this graph and makes fusion energy even more compelling. Unfortunately, there is still a third part of the graph that needs to be unlocked. This region is not accessible yet because with the reduction in size, it becomes hard to shield from the bombardment of high energy neutrons. The limit in magnetic field strength forced the old devices to become so large that no single country was willing to fund them alone. Due to the enormous cost of more than 50 billion euros, this project had to be a multinational collaboration, which made the project politically complicated and caused fusion development to stall. In the early 2000s, several countries that may not have been friendly in the past joined their effort in one large fusion experiment called ITER. ITER's purpose is to achieve a Q of 10 and to demonstrate that fusion technology is feasible. A Q of 10 would mean that it outputs 10 times more energy than it consumes. ITER is based on the tokamak design, which means it uses magnetic confinement to achieve high Q gains. However, ITER will not use the new superconductor, so in some ways by the time ITER is finished, the design may already be outdated. Another experiment proposed by MIT, called SPARc, will use the new superconductors and produce a much stronger magnetic field, therefore the device will be much smaller in size. Both SPARc and ITER are expected to be operational around 2025. Scientists are pretty confident that they will manage to achieve net energy gain, but regardless, these are just experiments, and an actual fusion power plant may take another 20 or 30 years to develop and build. So if everything goes as planned, fusion reactors might start sending electrons into the power grid in the 2050s. Thank you for watching, please don't forget to like and subscribe. You can also check out some of my other videos on the links shown. Thank you and see you soon.